So my name is Alexei Sava Mohajer Jaspi. I also go by Sabzi, DJ producer for Blue Scholars, Common Market, and a number of other town folk here in Seattle. Mass Line Media.
You're busy.
Busy, staying real busy.
How do you differentiate between the different bands? Like when you're working on a beat, what's the thing that knows that in your mind, okay, I'm working on Blue Scholars, I'm working on Common Market right now?
Well, I usually make the beat first. So it's not so much, it's kind of like at the, when the instrumental track is finished, that's when you decide, okay, this is for the Common Market, this is for Blue Scholars, or this is for neither, I should holler at, you know, Khalil holler or something like that. Holler at? I should get on my phone and call up Kings, a.k.a. Khalil from Abyssinian Creole or something like that. Because I think he'll kill this beat, or Dig from the Physics or something like that. So
awesome. So there's a interesting new scene developing in the Northwest based on hip-hop, but a conscious hip-hop.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you think that is?
Well, people say that there's this conscious hip-hop scene developing in the Northwest, and I kind of cringe when I hear that word.
Yeah.
Main thing is, like, to me, it's just there's a number of different people who are doing it now, making music, doing shows, putting out records in the Northwest, like there have been for a long time. But there just seems to be more attention on the scene at the moment, and it's inspiring a lot of other people to do stuff. And I just hope that all types of hip-hop music can sort of get some shine, and different styles can come to the surface, because I'd like to see what else this town has to offer, and we don't get stuck with this label of conscious.
Okay.
Like, for the most part, I don't think our music is conscious, but for some reason, because it doesn't have that double time hi-hats or something like that, people think, oh, it must be that conscious stuff.
So, first steps, what should somebody do?
What should somebody do? Well, somebody asked me, what are the first steps, what should somebody buy? And I think the main issue is, like, it's not about your gear, first and foremost. I know people, back when I used to be more into, like, scratch DJing, which I still do on the side, but, like, production, like, beats is really my main thing. I knew people who, like, spent less time, like, actually on their turntables and more time watching turntable TV or like researching the new gear, or like, oh, the ISP has this new mixer coming out, Vestax, can't wait to buy it. And there's people, and with the production game, it's worse, because there's all this gear that always comes out, and there's people who basically live at Guitar Center or they work there or something, and it's all about what gear they own and what it is that they bought, where nobody knows how to use any of this stuff. Like, I just showed you that I make this stuff using basically nothing. You know, it's a turntable, an old Mackie receiver mixer thing, and then this is the only thing I really spent money on. And I'm not even plugging this stuff in right, probably. There's probably, like, some audiophile that's gonna watch this and be like, that guy's insane. Like, he has no idea what he's doing. And you know what? You're right. I don't know what I'm doing. Because my main focus is, like, I'm trying to make music that sounds good. So I'd say, like, you can definitely cultivate and develop your craft by using pretty much any equipment that you have. Obviously, if you just have a rock and a bucket, then, like, you're limited with that. But, like, one of the reasons why I'm using software is because I did not have money to spend on things like this until I made money doing things like this, which is kind of ironic. It's kind of a catch-22. But there was a demo program of Acid that my friend got with his computer in 99. And before that, I had been playing around with Cakewalk, writing music and doing some sample-based stuff, like in like 97 in high school. And before that, I used to, like, I have two boomboxes where I'd have one, where do I have a boombox in here? I'd have one boombox and I'd record myself, like, playing the piano. And then I'd rewind it and turn it up really loud, and then record myself on another boombox with the playing boombox playing like buckets. And then I'd switch the tapes, turn this another one up really loud so it's piano and buckets, and play like saxophone and record myself on this new thing. And like, that's how we used to do stuff long before this digital thing started popping off. And so, like, when there was a free program, I started messing with that. I learned how to use it and eventually went out and got a better copy of it. And little by little, I've been adding these other things. But for the most part, I probably spent Yeah, very, very little money on gear. More, way more money on records, for example. Or way more money on food to sustain myself while making beats. Something like that. You see what I'm saying? Like, the point is that the time and energy is spent on the creative process. So really, it's just practice. I think first steps are practice. I think that if you don't know what kind of gear you want to work with yet, that's important. Just get out there and play with some of it. The best thing to do is find somebody who already has it and just use theirs for a little while. Like, if you liked how the MPC looks, go to your friend's house who has an MPC. Or go play with it at the store or something like that. Or if you want to check out some of these programs, you can easily get online and just download demos.
Mm-hmm.